So what we have now is not just a characterization of how we should pick a conjugate direction, or a next search direction, but actually a formulation that tells us how to compute it, because it changes our characterization into a linear least squares problem. But that doesn't really solve the problem, because notice that this linear least squares problem involves a matrix. Let's see, what does it look like? In the first iteration, you will have had no previous search directions, so this ends up being an n by 0 matrix. In the second iteration, it ends up being an n by 1 matrix, and so forth. And notice what that means is that we need to do a linear least squares problem. We need to solve a linear least squares problem with a matrix that, as time goes on, ends up with more and more columns. And then what do we do? Do we do normal equations? Do we use QR factorization? All of these methods are expensive. So the most remarkable result is, and perhaps this is one of the most remarkable results in linear algebra, is that if you push through the theory, in the end, what pops out is that the new search direction can be chosen to be a linear combination of the residual, well, we had that already, plus some multiple, let's call it gamma sub k, times the previous search direction. And that is astounding. What it means is, yes, the conjugate gradient method has memory in the sense that we inherently are finding the minimum over the span of all of the previous search directions, and therefore we know that after n steps we must be finished. Yet we don't need to remember all of that history, because the next search direction only depends on the previous search direction and the current residual. And notice that nothing else in the algorithm depends on the entire history of how we got here either. A truly, truly remarkable result. Now, the technical details that justify what I just said, the details are in the notes, you can go through that. But the final result is astounding.